I have to guess the true criminal on the streets of Milwaukee has the ability to obtain a firearm when needed from something other than a store, Stiller said. Guns stolen from ATF SUV. As the gun and drug trade buys continued, the operation went awry. In September, an agent parked his Ford Explorer at the alteration on North Humboldt Boulevard, about a half a mile away, with three ATF guns stored in a metal box in the back. About 3 p.m. September 13th, an Alteria employee spotted three men breaking into the Explorer. They stole three guns, a Smith & Wesson 9mm handgun, a Sig Sauer 40 caliber pistol, and an M4 223 caliber fully automatic rifle. They also made off with ammunition and an ATF radio, according to a police report. It does not appear in the reports that the agent was at Alteria at the time of the break-in. A major push began to find the weapons and the men who stole them, police records show. Two men were quickly arrested. An informant told police one of the suspects was showing off the guns and eight magazines of ammunition shortly after vehicle burglary, according to police records. One of the suspects hid the machine gun under a bed and took the handguns with him. He was questioned by police and refused to talk. He was released. No one has been charged in the burglary of the ATF guns, according to Milwaukee County Assistant District Attorney Karen Lobel. She declined to say if charges would be coming. The ATF soon had one of the stolen guns back, however. The very next day, according to court documents, 19-year-old Marquise Jones contacted agents at Fearless Distributing and sold the Sig Sauer, another unrelated handgun, back to agents. The price, $1,400. But Jones would not be arrested for 2 months, and when he was, it was not for the theft. His name does not appear on the police reports related to the vehicle break-in. He was charged with having a stolen gun. Meanwhile, the hunt for the machine gun and the other stolen handgun continues. We're actually looking for any missing firearms that might be out there right now, the ATF Schmidt said. Gerald Nunziato, a retired ATF agent who supervised undercover operations, said he was shocked at the number of mistakes made during the operation. He questioned the decision to leave the agent's truck at the coffee shop with guns inside. That bothers me the most, Nunziato said. The last thing you want is to have a gun stolen. If that gun is used to shoot someone, that is so personal. The operation ran into more trouble in October when burglars broke into the building housing Fearless and cleaned out the ATF operation. Late on October 9th, a resident who didn't want it to be identified spotted four men in the area in a car and a U-Haul truck who looked suspicious. He called police. Now here's an example why you should be self-protecting yourself. So he called police, but when they didn't come quickly enough, he went to the district station and reported that he saw a person. Police report shows officers came to investigate the next day. A Milwaukee policeman spokesman did not return a call for comment Tuesday. So this guy reports that a business is being broken into and the police never come. So he goes to the station and reports what he saw, and the police still don't go out until the next day. U-Haul and all made a clean getaway. I think they need to investigate the police for not doing their job. That's why probably crime is so high. The burglars made off with jewelry, clothing, auto parts, purses, Nike shoes, and more, according to police reports. No one has been charged in the burglary. The lease states that an alarm is included in the rent, but shortly after Fearless moved in, Salkin said he told the people running the store he was cutting the phone line, which connected the alarm. He said he assumed they would hook up their own alarm. They did not. You would think the ATF would know that, Salkin said. The day after the burglary, Salkin and his wife met with the ATF supervisor, who assured them that they would take care of everything. Salkin said, by going over on the $800 a month utility allotment and damage to the walls, doors, and carpeting, the ATF owes him about $15,000, which includes a month of lost rent. The ATF was balked, saying there was less than $3,200 in damage, and telling Salkin to return the security deposit. They told him to file a claim with the federal government and wanted him to stop contacting them. In an email to Salkin, ATF attorney Patricia Kangemi wrote, "If you continue to contact the agents after being so advised, your contacts may be constructed as harassment under the law. Threats or harassment of a federal agent is of grave concern. Utilizing the telephone or a computer to perpetrate threats or harassment is also a serious matter." Sounds like they were threatening him about collecting the money he was owed. Nunziato said he worked in an undercover ATF storefront operation in the 1980s near Detroit. He said they too didn't tell the landlord but when they left, they fixed the property to make sure it was as good or better when they moved in. Nazento said he could not fathom the Milwaukee agents just walking away from a damaged building. I can't. It's a different area. You're talking about the 80s and now here's the 2000s. You know, people don't have the same values like they did back then. And it doesn't matter if it's police, ATF, or whoever. To back up a toilet, not paying bills, and when damaging the building, he said, it seems like the planning of this case was not done very well. Looks like it was done as they went along. The River West neighborhood where ATF ran its operation is a mix of Milwaukee bungalows, flats, and duplexes, with many longtime homeowners mingled with renters. A few bars are sprinkled in along with the tannery and Sulkin's former sign company. The area has rallied against crime, lobbying to get a drug house closed. Well, you can't close a drug house if the police never respond, right? Neighbors developed a tight bond with their beat cop after a homicide occurred several blocks to the north. It's a whole mix of people here, and that's what I really love, said Lorraine Jacobs, a resident for 27 years. I wouldn't want to live anywhere else. Jacobs and the others feel betrayed by the ATF operation bringing drug dealers and gun sellers to their area. I feel like we're a fool taken advantage of, she says. It's unfortunate for our neighborhood. We are trying to bring it up, and we're close to that. We just didn't need this. Jason Reichel, who lives near Jacobs, said he would have preferred the operation wasn't in his neighborhood, but wouldn't want to push it off on another area. He said he is concerned ATF did not have control over the operation, given the store was ripped off. I would expect that the ATF wouldn't get robbed, that they would have security measures, he said. Maybe I watch too many movies. You would think it would be hard to rob an ATF operation. Turns out the ATF has weapons stolen or lost them more frequently than the public might think, according to a 2008 report from the Office of Inspector General with the U.S. Department of Justice. In a five-year span from 2002 to 2007, for example, 76 ATF weapons were stolen, lost, or missing, according to the report. That's nearly the double the number compared with the FBI and the U.S. Drug Enforcement Administration when considering rates per 1,000 agents. Todd Reichel, a resident for 5 years, wonders if the ATF operation explains two unusual crimes in the neighborhood. Over the summer, the wheels were stolen off his wife's SUV, which was left up on rocks. A couple of months later, thieves attempted to break into his shed. The ATF operation was buying stolen goods, but he is unsure if his wife's wheels ended up there. He said the ATF should have chosen a less residential area, perhaps an industrial park or retail area. I have two small children. This is going on while they're playing outside, he said. The stigma is damaging. Every neighborhood tries to make things better. It does not help to have your own government planting crime here, which takes down, destroys, and damages them. That's like, thanks. After the burglary, agents wound down the operation and prepared to make arrests in November. The defendants charged with drug crimes generally went to state court, while defendants facing gun cases, which also include drug charges, went to federal court. But during the roundup, ATF arrested and sought charges against three defendants who proved to be the wrong people, even though they had video of the defendants. One of those was Adrian Jones. ATF agents said Jones sold them 6 grams of marijuana on March 7th. Problem was, Jones reported to a federal prison in Pennsylvania to start in a sentence on March 1st, according to Chris Burke, spokesman for the Federal Bureau of Prisons on the ATF case. He was definitely in our custody, Burke said. He never left. Lobo, the prosecutor, dismissed the charges against Jones and the other two. She said agents told her that they could not prove elements of the charge. Under those circumstances, we want to make sure we get the right one, she said. You don't want to charge the wrong person. You certainly don't want to prosecute the wrong person. That is not something you strive for. Asked about the quality of the remaining 15 cases, Lobel would not say. She is proceeding with the prosecution of them and that they are all important. It is really a gamut of individuals and offenses, she said. My position is any amount of drugs, they have bad effect on people and on the community. ATF Schmidt said the agency always strives to identify the correct person before seeking charges against them. Certainly it is a concern, he said. I think they put their best effort forward and that it is their belief and information that these were the correct people. And it says Alan Vestal of the Journal Sentinel staff contributed to this report. I think he did a very good job. In the small town that I moved from, I had all kinds of problems with the locals. The adults would use children to do their harassment and crimes because, you know, kids get off easier than adults. I had 2 inches thick of police reports on file, and when I asked the local police for copies of my police reports, they said that they had to copy them and come back in about 2 weeks. So 2 weeks later, I went back for all my police reports, and they told me they lost them. I installed video cameras outside my home, which are recorded 24/7, and recorded a drive-by shooting. In the video was the car coming towards the house. You could see a man and a woman, you know, teenagers, young adults in there. They shot and killed an animal. In my yard, you can hear the gunshot going off. Luckily, when they shot, it didn't enter my house, and I was in city limits. I gave the videotape to the police so they could go after whoever it was doing their drive-by shoot. And the police told me that the videotape was too grainy because it was dark time, even though I had security lights on, and they couldn't identify who it was, which is bullcrap. I know with the technology they have for computer enhancement, they could have easily identified who these two people were. Another time, I actually caught 2 individuals on my property about 1 o'clock in the morning. The only reason I caught them was because the fellow had a bad alternator in his car, wouldn't start once he pulled into my driveway. They were from out of town, about 30 miles away, and it turned out that the girl who was in the car, who I found hiding on the floor of the car when I went outside to find out why they were on my property, was the cousin of the local police. So the officer who responded pushed their car 2 blocks down the road to get it started. And he says to me, when I told him I wanted charged with trespassing, "Gee, Mary, be glad at least we got him off your property." Now, I won't go into the details of things that they've done to me other than killing a cat, hanging it from a tree in my yard, and running over one of my dogs, and the vandalism to my vehicle. And not once was any prosecution ever done. I no longer live there. And I could go on and on with the list of crimes committed against me and my family that the police never protected us from. Of course, when one of the local officers who worked the jail found out that I bought a shotgun, she was very concerned about that. Well, why should I buy a shotgun, seeing how I have no protection from the police, even when I catch intruders on my property? All right, bookmark my site. I'll keep everyone up to date. Please stay safe, and I'll talk to you later. God bless y'all. Bye.